Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Amen. Welcome everybody. And welcome the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Wonderful to come into his presence. Amen. Praise the Lord. I want to welcome Brother Ivan and Sister Edna. God bless you. Wonderful to have you. Amen. Of course, Brother Paul LaFontaine and Sister Rebecca. God bless you. Amen. Always good to gather with the saints of God. I hope I didn't miss anybody. I know there's more to come, maybe tomorrow, God willing. Praise the Lord. Are you glad tonight to be in the house of God? Amen. Where else would you rather be? Praise the Lord. Not in trying, but in trusting. Let's sing that tonight. And ask Brother Alec if you just come and open in prayer. And of course, remember Brother Paul as he brings the Word of God. And remember also the saints around the island and around the world as well. And of course, Brother Paul's congregation as well, who are without their pastor tonight. Amen. And Sister Cordella, we understand she's still recovering and doing well. So God's grace to them. Of course, remember your loved ones as well. And may God just bless us and keep us in his presence tonight. Amen. Also, good to have Brother Paul and Sister Kimberly back, of course. Amen. We got all our musicians back now. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. So let's sing, It's Not in Trying, But in Trusting. Let's trust the Lord tonight, whatever your need might be. You don't need to try, don't need to work anything up. What you got to do is believe God. Amen. You just got to trust him. Amen. Let's just sing it tonight, and Brother Alec will lead in prayer. It's not in trying, but in trusting.
Yes,
it's not in running, but in resting. Hallelujah. It's not in wandering, but in praying, that we find the strength of the Lord. It's not in trying, but in trusting. Amen. It's not in running, but in resting. Hallelujah. It's not in wandering, but in praying, that we find the strength of the Lord. It's not in trying, but in trusting.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
It's not in running, but in resting. Hallelujah. It's not in wandering, but in praying, that we find the strength of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let's bow our hearts together. Amen. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you again, Lord, for this glorious privilege, Father, to be gathered, Lord, into the house of prayer again.
Hallelujah.
Father, to worship you.
Hallelujah.
Worship you in spirit and in truth, Father. We come tonight, Lord, with thankful hearts, and Lord, just asking and inviting your presence to be amongst us, Lord, according to the promises of your word, for two or three are gathered,
praise
you will be
Lord.
There,
praise
and that to bless, Lord. So may each heart tonight, Father, be circumcised afresh,
Amen.
Father, in your presence.
Hallelujah.
Lord, we just ask that you would bless all that will be said and done this service, Father.
Amen.
Singing of the songs of Zion to
yes.
praise you and worship you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
We pray for the going forth of the word. We thank
Amen.
You for
thank you.
Bringing
yes,
our
Lord.
Precious
praise.
Brother Paul LaFontaine here, Lord. We,
Amen.
We come with expectation. We pray, O God, that you'll anoint our brother tonight,
Amen.
Lord.
Hallelujah.
The Holy Spirit, Lord, that he could minister, Lord, the things that we have need of, Lord, in this
Amen.
Very hour, in this crucial time, Lord, this walk of faith we are on, like
Amen.
As Enoch walked, Lord, the bride is walking, looking for a change
Hallelujah.
Of the body, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Oh, God, put a greater thirst and hunger in our souls tonight, we pray,
yes,
Lord. As we draw closer to you, Lord, lift us up into those heavenly places
Hallelujah.
In Christ
Amen.
Jesus, Lord.
Amen.
Where you can just have full preeminence in this portion of the
yes.
bride tonight, Lord, we pray.
Amen.
Father, remember the prayer requests that have been spoken here and unspoken ones, Lord. Each one of us have loved ones upon our hearts, Lord,
Amen.
That we
yes.
Father, are outside the ark of safety tonight, Lord. We just pray, oh God, that you would move by the Holy Spirit, Lord. Bring them in, oh God. Father, the hour is late, Lord. Lord, we want to go home. Lord Jesus, just move in the hearts. We thank you, Lord, for the reports of those that have recently come to faith, Lord. We pray, oh God, that you will quicken the word to those, Lord, that need that quickening power again tonight in their souls. So, Father, we commit the service to you. Bless your bride and all the earth, Father.
Amen.
Bless the musicians tonight as they play.
Yes.
Bless the singers as they sing. Bless our brother Bob as he leads, Lord. May the Holy Spirit be his portion. Each and every one, Father, we commit this service to you. We ask it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you. You can be seated. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's bring up 355. And that is higher ground. I'm pressing on the upward way to heights I'm gaining every day.
Yes,
amen. That's a testimony in itself. Still praying as I'm onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I'm pressing on. us.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Every verse in there is a prayer to me.
Amen.
Amen. I want to scale the utmost height. I want to live above the world. What? That's the desire of a believer.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's what we want to do. We want to be above this world, and the sooner the better. Flying like the eagle, like Brother Gerald has preached, into the presence of the Son.
Amen.
S-O-N. Praise the Lord. Let's sing Jesus on the Inside. 700.
Amen.
Jesus on the inside. To what we are by
Amen.
Grace, and there's more change to come. Amen. And we're looking for that great change, a great change where we'll get a new body out of it.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Let's sing I Will Proclaim. It's
Hallelujah.
All heaven declares the glory of the living of the risen Lord. Praise the Lord.
Forever he will be.
praise the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. He once was slain to reconcile a man to God. He was slain to reconcile this man to God.
Amen.
Amen. Make it personal. Amen. He did it to all of us, for all of us, by grace. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. We got a couple of specials tonight, so let's be in prayer for them. Sister Priscilla is going to come first, and then Brother John is going to come and sing. So let's just sing God Still Moves. It's 9:16 as they get ready to come. So Sister Priscilla first, then Brother John, okay. God still moves. God still moves. Amen.
Give a little testimony. We're taught that you should find yourself in the Bible, so I'm just gonna read a few verses here.
Thank you, Lord.
It's in Psalm 119. It says, "Thou hast dwelt well."
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
With thy servant. Lord, according unto thy word, before I was afflicted, I went astray. But now I have kept thy word.
Yes,
thou art good and doest good. Teach me thy statutes.
Amen.
It is good for me that I have been afflicted, that I might learn thy statutes.
Amen.
Thy hands have made me and fashioned me. Give me understanding that I may learn thy commandments. They that fear thee will be glad when they see me, because I have hoped in thy word.
Amen.
I know, O Lord, that thy judgments are right, and that thou in faithfulness hast afflicted me. Let, I pray thee, thy merciful kindness be for my comfort, according to thy word unto thy servant. Let thy tender mercies come unto me, that I might live, for thy law is my delight. Remember the word unto thy servant upon which thou hast caused me to hope, This is my comfort in my affliction, for thy word hath quickened me.
Praise the Lord.
So I'd just like to, again, publicly thank the Lord for healing me.
Hallelujah!
Body, mind, and soul. I come, God, I come. Return to the Lord, the one who's broken, the one who's torn me apart. You strike down to bind me up. You say you do it all in love, that I might know you in your suffering. Though you slay me, yet I will praise you. Though you take from me, I will bless your name.
Hallelujah.
Though you ruin me, still I will worship, sing a song to the one who's all I need. My heart and flesh may fail, the earth below give way, but with my eyes, I'll see the Lord lifted high upon that day. Behold the Lamb that was slain, and I'll know that every tear was worth it all. Your name,
hallelujah.
Though you ruin me,
Thank you, Lord.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen. Face to face, for you are my King.
don't need to reach my soul. You carry on and mend me on. And your grace, Lord, be mine. For I must belong from time to eternity. You will never be lost again. You were the first to raise for me when no one else would do. You took a journey to reach my soul. You carry on, man, me on. And your grace brought me back where I first belong. From time to eternity, journey to reach my soul. You carry on and mend me on. And your grace brought me back where I first belong. From time to the eternity, we will never be lost again.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Wonderful. Amen. Thank God for the specials. We should have had maybe a few more.
Amen.
That would have been our song service. Amen. So thank the Lord. It was a real blessing. So God bless Sister Priscilla and our brother John.
Amen.
Amen. It's singing revelation. It's just not singing religion. It's revelation.
Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord. And it's a revelation that the bride understands. Not many religious people understand it, but the bride understands it. Back to where we come from. Amen. They don't understand that. They don't have the full comprehension of that revelation as the bride does. But God is revealing things to the bride that he's not revealing to them. Amen. Because he's expecting something of the bride he's not expecting of them.
Amen.
And that is the resurrection and the rapture. As the prophet has said, he said, regarding the resurrection, the rapture, he said, God is waiting on us.
Amen.
Amen. Right. They are out there, all due respect to them, but they are waiting on God. But he said, God is waiting on us. Why?
Amen.
Because God has given us the revelation.
Right.
Amen. Concerning the end, concerning his coming, concerning the resurrection, concerning the rapture. So, brother, it's not me waiting on him. It's him waiting on me. It's him
Amen.
Waiting on you. Because he has given us the faith, the revelation of the resurrection.
Amen.
The faith, the revelation of the rapture. And not only that, the prophet said the dead in Christ are waiting on us. Amen. It's not waiting on God, but it's in a sense, it's God, it's Christ in us. Amen. But listen, let's not just push it all to him. He wants to get control of you.
Yes.
Amen. For to bring that resurrection.
Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord. So to God be the glory.
Yes.
Amen. We're getting closer and closer to the change.
Yes.
Amen. I have been changed and I will be changed.
Yes.
I have been resurrected and I will experience a greater resurrection.
Yes.
Amen. I've got it in my soul. I'm going to have it in my full being. Amen. Even my natural fleshly being. And I've been raptured, caught up into a heavenly place in Christ. Amen. Spiritually in my soul. Where the word is revealed to give me a greater faith to be caught up physically. Amen. And to receive a glorified body like unto his glorious body. To God be the glory. This is tremendous. Amen. As our brother said, brother, we don't have to go through this no more. Jesus won't have to do it no more. His purpose, his plan, and his pattern is all fulfilled.
Amen.
Amen. And he's got the elect here tonight that love him for himself.
Amen.
Amen. You love him for his character. You love him for his nature. You love him for what he's done for you.
Amen.
And you're going to love him through all eternity. By the grace of God. Wonderful that we're going back to where we come from.
Amen.
Amen. As I said, I've got it right here in my Bible. And I typed it and I just stamped it into the Bible there on the bottom. And it says, heaven. Some call it heaven. I call it home.
Amen.
We're going home. Amen. Definitely. So, and brother, it's not going to be strange to us. No. Oh, well, praise the Lord. This is a strange place. We're pilgrims and strangers here.
Amen.
But when we get there, we're not pilgrims and we're not strangers.
Amen.
Amen. We're the sons and daughters of God redeemed. And even what? We're redeemed not even unto the bride of the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise the name of the Lord. So to God be the glory. Amen. So I want to thank God for this service tonight. And our brother Ivan and Sister Edna, amen. God bless you. Amen. And also we're expecting others to be with us tomorrow, coming from Central Newfoundland. So let's believe that God is in it. And it's all for a reason. God is going to minister through the ministry, but you got to receive it in your heart and in your soul. You got to receive it through the Holy Ghost. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. The baptism of the Holy Ghost, brother, is our passport into glory. The baptism of the Holy Ghost is our passport into the resurrection, into the rapture, by the grace of God. Amen. Don't think you're going to make it without the baptism of the Holy Ghost, because it is Christ in us. Amen. Christ said, I'll not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Amen. By the grace of God. And he's with us, in us, and moving us on. The elect of God, he's calling many, but he chooses few for as his bride. And I trust that we're those numbered with those few. Amen. So the Lord bless us and pray God's grace to those that will be traveling tomorrow to be with the in the Saturday service and the Sunday morning service. Amen. And also to welcome back again we have two Brother Pauls here tonight. Amen. But our Brother Paul Coffey is not going to preach. Amen. So we welcome our Brother Paul Coffey and our Sister Kimberly. And we're requesting prayer for our Sister Kimberly. Amen. And she needed prayer when she was gone. Now she needs prayer since she's come back, and she's going to need it for the next maybe 8 months.
Amen.
Amen. And then we'll have a dedication. And not dedicating Sister Kimberly. No, but she'll provide someone for me to dedicate. Amen. So God bless Sister Kimberly and Brother Paul. Amen. And as they move on towards that great change in their life. Amen. So to God be the glory. And also I want to welcome our Brother Paul LaFontaine and our Sister Rebecca.
Amen.
Not Becca. Rebecca. Three, not two. Yeah. So we welcome them. And we last met them, I guess, was at Brother Paul's wedding a couple of years ago in Ohio. And Brother Paul LaFontaine performed the marriage. And Brother Gerald Lush, if you know him, he prayed over the brother and sister that was married. Amen. And committed them to the Lord. We thank God he has kept them and is keeping them. But we welcome our brother Paul LaFontaine. And he's not exactly the same age he was when I first met him. And that was in 1988. Yes, 1988. We were attending a convention in Brother Harold Hildebrand's assembly. In Alberta, and the convention was not in the assembly, but it was in an auditorium in the university. And of course, ministering brethren and others sat on the platform, and I remember that just a seat or two seats from me was Brother Paul LaFontaine. He was just a young man, and sitting behind Brother Paul LaFontaine was Brother Perry Green. I don't know if he remembers that, but I remember it. Amen, because I had fellowship with Brother Green during that convention. And also after the last sermon was preached and your pastor was asked to close the service and close the convention in prayer. And after that, I was on my way down from the pulpit to the exit, and a brother came up to ask me some questions. And it was Brother... Tom, is it Tom LaFontaine? John LaFontaine. It was Brother Paul's father. So I was going down, but he was coming up, and he just wanted to ask me some questions concerning the word and the message that was preached and so on. So it's been quite a while since I've met our brother Tom and our brother Paul. Amen. And it's amazing that since 88 that the Lord would turn it around and bring our brother Paul back to minister to us here. Amen. So we certainly want to welcome our brother Paul and pray the grace of God in his heart and soul. Amen. The grace of God that he'll have that power, that anointing to get himself out of the way. So it's not him that we're going to hear. It's Jesus. Amen. It's that Christ is going to minister to us tonight through our brother Paul. Amen. And it was just not long ago, just a few days ago, that I did hear our brother Paul minister in Ohio. And it was on the internet, of course. And I said, oh, praise the Lord. I said, that'll fit right in here, into the assembly here.
Amen.
So we thank the Lord for that. Amen. And pray, be in prayer for our brother Paul as we give the turn the pulpit over to him. Let's stand, and we're going to sing Only Believe, All Things Are Possible, Only Believe. So be in prayer. Amen. Yeah? Well, he's got the liberty to take as much time as he wants.
Amen, that's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
Maybe Brother Matthew might do as he done to when Brother Andre Head was there. He might remove the clock.
Amen.
Oh, he just removed it. Well, I heard Brother Bill Agassiz say one time, he said, listen, he said, this is one thing that should never be in a church, and that's a clock. Amen. So I could say amen to that. And I did. Amen. I was on the platform when he said it. But there was a clock in the building. So he would be pleased to come into it here tonight. So God rest his soul. Amen. So let's sing Only Believe, All Things Are Possible, Only Believe, as we turn to our brother Paul. Amen. To God be the glory. Amen. Glad to have our brother with us. Amen. Let's sing it. Only believe, only believe.
Yes, Lord.
All things are possible. Only believe, only believe.
Thank you, Lord.
Jesus is here.
Jesus is here.
God bless you, Brother Paul.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord!
Amen. All things are possible. Jesus is here. Oh, Jesus is here. Jesus is here. All things are possible. Jesus is here.
God bless you. You may be seated. I wanted to say what joy it is to be here in Newfoundland for the first time.
Amen.
And Brother Gerald asked us to come last year, and we weren't able to make it work. And I like to keep my promises, so this is fulfilling a promise to come up and be able to visit with you all and be able to spend time in the Word of God and in fellowship. So we thank you for laying out just such a welcome when we got here, and a nice motel room and a bunch of snacks from the sisters and brothers, and just different things that just show that you're giving us a warm welcome.
Amen.
And I appreciate that so much. May God bless you for it. And I'm looking forward to a good weekend with you, and just be able to see what the Lord would help us with. And we're all striving for the same thing, have the same goal. Can you say amen? That's common in our hearts.
Amen.
And so we just put our shoulder to the wheel. I was just praying earlier, speaking to the Lord, that There isn't anything in me anymore to come and think that I'm better than any church or anything, but I actually put my shoulder to the wheel with you and what God's doing here, that I can be a contribution to that.
Amen.
And we're all striving for the same thing. So that's my motive. That's my objective, to be able to join in with you. And if I can help and contribute to what the Lord's doing here, that's my desire to be able to do it. So we have some family connections here as well, and different ones that through the years we've had connections. And of course, Brother Barry is from here, and he's a close friend. And so, but I have, I'm starting to really enjoy his brothers and his family, and I find that I can get information from them that I can't necessarily get from Barry about his childhood and life. So that's some interesting stories for sure, but we're very excited. And then Sister Kimberly, of course, is here. She's going to help us sing a little bit tonight. She used to sing with us, and she was also my, did some secretarial administrative stuff for me. And I'm learning through the years to not get a single sister as a secretary, because you lose them eventually. Matter of fact, she probably hadn't told you this, but when I listed, I said, I'm going to put all your instructions on a piece of paper, hang on the wall, so you know what it is I want you to do for me, you know, for administrative things for the church and all that. And so I had a whole list of stuff, and the bottom was, don't get married. And she disobeyed that one. And her sister is actually helping me now, and she has an interest in the fellow now. She's my secretary, but she has an interest, so I've got another distracted secretary. So I'm headed in the same direction, I think. But you know what? We hated to lose Sister Kimberly. She was a great Holy Ghost-filled sister contribution to our young people and the church. And so, but to see her now fit in so well, and just such a blessing here, and also she's talked so much about you and just the congregation, and just enjoying the presence of the Lord here. We're just glad to see her here, and she's also talked about her husband as well, but Brother Paul number one, we'll call him Brother Paul number one and Brother Paul number two, because when I come in Newfoundland, he's number one and I'm number two. But thanks for the warm welcome, and we just appreciate that wherever we go. We don't get that everywhere we go, but we are thankful for it when we get it, so we appreciate it. So I'm going to have my wife come. Sister Rebecca's with me, and Sister Kimberly, and if you don't mind, we'll sing a couple songs here tonight.
Amen.
We've had a lot of good singing already. We almost don't need to sing, because we've already had some good specials. But we're trying to... Yes, what I meant by my family is my cousin Amber. She's coming home up here too, but just happy to see her. Should have it on. You want to just use this one? Okay. How is that? Is that better?
Yeah.
All right.
Test. Jesus said that in the midnight hour, there'll be virgins who hear the great cry. Behold, he cometh, rise and trim your lamps, go and meet him, the bridegroom is nigh. But some discovered they were lacking the oil, they were empty with no light to see. So I ask you, dear Lord, come and fill me with your spirit, keep me burning for you is my plea. I want to be burning, burning the midnight. With my lamp all trimmed and glowing, a vessel full of the Holy Ghost, I will shine the light through the night to the word I must be loyal. There is a virgin bride burning the midnight. I really get to wondering why it it's a struggle to get down and pray. Feel the spirit of complacency. We're surrounded by the darkest day. I'll keep holding up this light of mine. And I'm working day and night with the ones who hold the promise. It is time for us to rise and shine. I want to be burning, burning the midnight oil. Yes, Lord, with my lamp all trimmed and glowing. Oh, a vessel full. Your desire?
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Amen. That's our desire. Keep burning the midnight oil. Amen. Blessed be his name. I love this song. My wife and I sing, and Sister Kimberly used to sing it with us. We're going to sing it tonight. He's everywhere.
Every coming up to this beautiful country up here. It's a good song to sing. You can see God.
Amen.
And all the wonderful creation. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Praise
amen.
The Lord. If you don't mind standing again, we're going to read a scripture together tonight and share in the Word of God. And we're going to read from Romans chapter 8. We bring you greetings from Literal Life Church and the saints there. And my father and mother, my father, I think, is listening in on the streaming. And him and mom really wanted to come with us because they had a trip, I think some 35 years ago to Newfoundland.
Amen.
They never forgot it. They always wanted to come back. I'm not sure their health is up to coming back now, but they always, Brother Nelson Guy had them, and they've always fell in love with Newfoundland and always wanted to come back. So when I was leaving the other day, they sure wish they could jump in the car with me and go and get on the plane with me, but they're just not able this time. But I think he's listening in tonight.
Amen.
So you all say God bless you to my mom and dad.
Amen.
Amen. So maybe the Lord will help them and give them some healing in their body, and maybe they'll be able to come someday. Praise the Lord. Romans chapter 8, and we're just going to read a few sections of scriptures here. And I trust the Lord will bless you and anoint this service tonight, that your Christian walk with the Lord can be furthered and that we can grow to know him a little deeper. And so we're thankful for the light of the message upon the scripture, that we could enjoy the revelations of God in this day. There's been some things just burdening me, and tonight I don't have something that is necessarily that I normally preach, but I've just had some things gnawing at me from the Lord as I asked the Lord, what can I speak to the people up there? And so he has me leaning in a certain direction here tonight.
Amen.
And so we'll just see where the Lord takes this evening. So we're reading from Romans chapter 8, and we'll just pick it up here at Romans chapter 8. Let's pick it up here at verse 14. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God.
Amen.
For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption,
Amen.
Whereby we cry, Abba, Father.
Amen.
The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. So we see that Paul's already introducing here that we receive a spirit. And there's really only two spirits when it's in relation to righteousness. We either receive a spirit of fear or we receive a spirit of adoption.
Amen.
And we have not received the spirit of fear, which would be denominational or some type of religion.
That's right.
To cause us to live things out of fear.
Amen.
We haven't received that kind of spirit.
Amen.
When we receive the true Holy Ghost, we don't
Amen.
Do the things of God out of fear. We do it because he's placed within us.
That's right.
A spirit of adoption to take us to maturity and adoption, and that work within us is going to do the work. So it's totally different than religion. Can you say amen?
Amen?
So that's what he introduces first, and then he says here, verse 18, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. So there he's in prophecy now as he spoke of the Spirit coming and what it is that's within us throughout the ages. The Holy Ghost is the spirit of adoption. And now he's going into prophecy. And it says in verse 19, this is the main scripture I wanted you to get tonight, for the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. So I'm saying it was prophecy back in Paul's day for him to say this. It's coming to pass now.
Amen.
But back in this day, he's speaking prophecy. Now this spirit of adoption in the people is going to bring a people to adoption,
Amen.
Bring them to the completion of adoption. And that's the hour we live in. So now for the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God.
Amen.
For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. So can you imagine something so powerful going on within us to bring us to this adoption
amen.
That all of creation is waiting on this?
Amen.
Can you say amen?
Amen?
All of creation is waiting for you and I to come to our position in place. Because
right.
When we get delivered, they get delivered.
Amen.
When we receive redemption and we're completely redeamed, it redeems the entire earth back again. Because at Calvary, he purchased redemption not only for his people, but the entire earth.
Amen.
But it's waiting on sons of God. And so now, for we all know that the whole creation groaneth and travail in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also are groaning within ourselves. We're groaning within ourselves, which have the first fruit, the down payment, or the down payment of his spirit. Even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? So I just want to stop there at 23 and leave that last thought, because that's prophecy as well, showing we're waiting for the adoption, to wit, the completion, and that is the redemption of our body. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the people here and the saints of God in Newfoundland and the warm welcome they have given. And Lord, we've enjoyed the songs and the opportunities that we have to get together and worship you. And Lord, wherever two or three are gathered, you said you'd meet, Lord, with us. And you're here among us tonight. And so we humble ourselves to your word, and we pray that you'll speak to us intimately, Lord. We pray that you'll bless every soul that's here. We pray, Father, that you'll help me and use the gift you've given me, Lord, to encourage and admonish and strengthen the congregation here. And we pray that you'll bless the saints at home as well. And God, we give you the glory for all things. We pray you'll bless the word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated tonight. God bless you. You know, saints of God, when we're living in the season that we're living in of the Word, and how it's open to us, that we're entering into such a wonderful season spiritually. When the message came to us through a prophet, we realized it opened a new season for the bride. Yeah. And we're entering such a wonderful season. It's an exciting thing. It's a very exciting thing. And I want to just take my time tonight and just lay a foundation for something. I want to speak about the expectation to see mature sons.
Amen.
The expectation to see mature sons. And I'm sure the Lord has some other things that maybe they're out this weekend. We'll just be praying for a direction. But I just want to lay a foundation from the scripture here that it is an exciting time when he begins to move us into these seasons at the end time and prophecy being fulfilled. And we see what has already been fulfilled in front of us. And when we see some things fulfilled that are in the Bible, so clearly fulfilled in front of us, the last 50, 60, 70 years, as we see even more than that, the end time prophecies, beginning with the prophet bringing us back to the Word, and he rose with healing in his wings, as the scripture said, so the ministry began with the healing campaigns. And then we see the phase of him that going into the third pole, we see all that happening, but we know that the prophet is gone now, but you see it entered the bride into a new season. And when we see all of that fulfilled in front of us, then what it does is it sets us under expectation then.
Amen.
Because we've seen that what people expected before, this is what's supposed to happen. They were under expectation for God to send a prophet. But once you enter the cycle of God fulfilling that, then we living in that kind of cycle, it actually sets us under a greater expectation.
Amen.
Can you say amen? Because we know that God's become real to us.
Amen.
We know that he's fulfilled Malachi 4:5.
Right.
And those who know that by revelation, we receive a great confidence in God that we're in a new season of expectation.
Amen.
For God to fulfill and finish the work he said to do at the last days.
Right.
So, you know, expectation is a wonderful word. I trust that you're under expectation for these meetings.
Amen.
Like I am. It's a wonderful thing for the bride. And so expectation is a wonderful thing. And especially when we have a living God that has made himself known in such a way in this age, not just through the prophet, but in many ways now through the bride, we have a living God who's come real close to us. Not a distant God anymore, but he's shown himself visible among us and revealed himself as Son of Man. We see that. And so when that happens, it sets us under expectation. And so then we see what God can do as a living God. And so that being said, being under the right expectations, here's the next point I want to make. Being under the right expectations is so important. Okay, it's being under the right expectations is so important because it's been proven that through time now people can be preached under false expectation.
Amen.
You see? And we not only out there in the nominal world, but also in within our ranks, that unfortunately, when the devil misguides people, the people are preached under false expectations.
Amen.
And that's when man injects his own ideas,
right,
and what the Holy Ghost wanted to do and accomplish, man injects his ideas, and through his authority, then he sets the people, because all of us preachers, we are setting the people under expectations. No matter what we're doing,
Amen,
that's the only result. We're preaching people under certain expectations,
Amen,
of what's coming down the road or what's coming in our lives next.
Amen.
And so we preach people, but you see, if we're not in tune with the Holy Spirit, we can preach the people under false expectations. And they're looking for something that's supposed to happen, but it's not necessarily scriptural. It's an interpretation of man. So this is what we look for. This is what we're set under expectations. And those of us who've been around the message for quite a while, we can see that even in our own ranks, where preachers preach the people under certain expectations, and then that doesn't come to pass, and it makes the people disappointed and discouraged. It is so important that we find the right expectations,
Hallelujah,
to set the people under for this hour.
Amen.
So crucial. Can you say amen? So now when we look at these things, then we see that brothers can do that sometimes, and they are sincere. And I want to say that about sometimes people who get misled or preachers, they're sincere because all they really want to do, they want to know what's next. They want to know where we're going next. God sent us the message, where are we going next? But that point is such a crucial point that we pray and lean on the Holy Ghost so that we set the people under the right expectations.
Amen.
So hopefully you're grabbing hold of these points because they're just so important as we move along. So we see now that when people preach that way, they're sincere many times, but misled into expecting the wrong thing. Once we're in the cycle of the seventh seal, which we are, we're in the cycle of the seventh seal. Brother Branham called it that we're in that cycle. Not all of it's fulfilled yet, but he said we're in that cycle.
Amen.
And I'll tell you, friends, I cannot overemphasize to you. In other words, I don't have the language to describe to you how significant it is to be entered the cycle of the seventh seal,
Amen,
which is the coming of the Lord.
Amen.
I don't have a language to describe that because
Amen.
It's when he took that book in Revelation chapter 10, when the Lamb took the book of our redemption and is going to take the seals off of it, Brother Branham says that's the most sublime thing in the scripture.
Hallelujah.
Our Lamb, Jesus Christ,
Amen,
our kinsman, takes the book of redemption,
Amen,
and is ready to take the seals off. Can you say amen?
Amen.
It's the most sublime thing in the scripture.
Amen.
So being in the cycle of all that is a very, very wonderful thing.
Amen.
This is the greatest thing that's hit planet
Amen.
Earth.
That's right.
This cycle that we're in is the greatest cycle man has ever been in before.
Amen.
This is a cycle of complete redemption.
Yeah.
We're under the power of redemption.
Hallelujah.
Your life has come under the power of redemption.
Amen.
Despite yourself, despite your mistakes, if you're under the influence of God, you've come under the power of redemption.
That's right.
And that Holy Ghost has now taken that power. It's so powerful. It puts you back where Adam fell in the beginning.
Amen.
You're not going to do it yourself. He'll put you back where Adam fell from. And we'll get into that tonight. This is a powerful cycle we're in. That says that the book of redemption, and we're now feeding on that book of redemption. That's a pretty powerful time to live in. But once we're in the cycle of the seven seals, or the seventh seal, excuse me, I want to tell you that troubles can arise during that time from human efforts as people begin to say, what's next?
Amen.
Right? Because once you're in the cycle of you see God fulfilled, then everybody's saying, what's next? What's next? And I know that the rapture is next, but I'm just saying, how do we get there? How do we finish this? And I think sometimes we ought to leave it alone. Because when men try to interpret what's next, well, they get in trouble.
That's right.
And you find even in the seventh seal, Brother Branham gives warnings. Don't try to interpret this.
Right.
Don't do anything to this. Just live a good, godly Christian life. If God wants you to know anything, he'll reveal it to you. I think a lot of preachers should have listened to what he said and leave it alone.
That's right.
Leave it alone, can you say amen? We're in the cycle. The Holy Ghost will do it. Yield to him, can you say amen?
Amen.
But that moment of being in that cycle and watching things makes the people say, what's next sometimes? And when you're asking that, sometimes it can bring people into false expectations, interpreting it. And I just want to tell you tonight, I'm hungry and looking to see in the people of God the final result of what this message was supposed to produce.
Amen.
I'm under expectation for that.
Amen.
The right thing, not man's interpretation. I was telling the brothers at supper last night, that I was speaking about it, and say, you know, we have watched this for a long time now. And to see sincere men sometimes take people down a path with a desire to get the final result to this message, the final result to what Christ is trying to accomplish. And we watch them, and they try to get to it their own way, and then we see the fruit of that after many years. It didn't bring the right fruit.
Yeah.
It didn't bring the right thing.
Yeah.
And so you go to look at it and say, no, that's not it. That's not where we were supposed to go. We see people taken to a place of all kinds of different doctrines and things, and you say, no, that's the end result is not just that we have the doctrine all just right.
Yeah, right.
Some people think you get all the doctrine just right, it's going to solve every problem, it's going to be everything, but this isn't just an ending of perfectly right in doctrine. This isn't the end result of this is not to make us a bunch of intellectuals that know all the quotes. That's not the end result of this. But a lot of conventions, it's like if we just preach all the mysteries, it'll just bring all the people in knowing all these things. But it's deeper than that.
Right.
It's not just the mysteries.
Amen.
There's something deeper than just the mysteries.
Amen.
The mysteries are to bring us to a result.
That's right.
That's not unscriptural. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 13, he says, though I understand all mysteries and have not love, I'm nothing.
Amen.
So there's something greater. There's another expectation.
Amen.
Not doing away with the mysteries, but you see now, it's to bring us individually to somewhere.
Amen.
They think if you get church order just perfectly right. A lot of churches, if we can get church order perfectly right, then we've reached the ultimate. That's it. And I'll tell you, that's not the goal.
That's right.
We believe church order.
Amen.
If I can get all the women just perfectly right, then that's the goal. And everybody can see what. No, that's not the final goal.
That's right.
Not doing away with dress. It's important. Dress is important. But you see, what is the final expectation to see in the bride?
Amen.
Can I get an amen tonight?
Hallelujah.
So now you look at the fruits of some of those things, and the doctrine sometimes it seemed to be so right and so deep, or even camps that are emotional, highly emotional, if they end up at the end after a few years with more worldliness, more intellectual, more pride. I'm saying for myself personally, I'm standing back and saying, if that's the end result of that thing within our ranks, I'm not on board.
Amen.
Because the end result isn't more pride.
Yeah.
The end result isn't more intellectuals.
That's right.
The end result isn't to have the next big deep preacher, and that's not the end result.
Amen.
Can you say amen?
Amen?
So we have to know what we're under expectation for. And even the prophet in his day observed, and I found this today and I'm adding it in, even the prophet observed after all of the supernatural meetings and healing campaigns sweeping across the nation, it didn't bring the results after a while, all of the healings. And I'm studying that now. I'm starting 47, 48. It's incredible what the Lord did to this nation, Canada, and also United States. You talk about a sweeping of a healing campaign. And I'm sure Brother Gerald was part of some of that and watched it. I mean, this is a massive supernatural work of God. And in Canada and the United States, it was amazing to see the night after night and what miracles took place. But you see now, after, and I think I'm reading here in 1959 where he said, he was watching, he said, we've had miracles, we had things that God has had men to wait. He's performed miracles, it never changed the country. See, sin is on the rampage worse than it ever was and moved right into the locks of the church and tore it up. What did our miracles do? What did our healing campaigns? I believe in divine healing, sure, but you can never major on a minor.
That's right.
Divine healing is a minor. We could never major on those things. The church ought to be in a maturity.
Amen.
So now that's my subject tonight, is that expectations for mature sons.
That's right.
And what he's saying here is that all of those healing campaigns doesn't bring the end result that we're looking for if you don't have sons growing into maturity to come to their personal position and place in Christ.
Amen.
You understand? And that's quite a statement, and I'm glad he made it and not me, because you realize he's the one that observed all these healing campaigns. He wants the supernatural hand of God firsthand. You know, we've seen it, but he's seen it every night working in that way. And yet after in 1959, he's going, but what has it got us? I mean, where are we really at? Is it bringing the final end result? And you're well taught here in the church, so you understand some of the reasons that we know is that you can't stay in the first and second pole. You got to move on to the third pole. So we understand those things. But I'm bringing the point tonight that he's saying that the church ought to be maturity. And we've had rushing winds and we've had all kinds of sensations. And of course, he's in the subject of Elijah being there. And God wasn't in the wind, and God wasn't in the thing that all those mighty loud things. You understand? I'm just referring back to it. But He found God in a still small voice. So the prophet takes that. He says, "We've had rushing winds. We've had all kinds of sensation. Where's the church at? Where are we today? Still more denominations growing every day, and colonizing, and everything, and still." The same men. I'd like you to look at it. Denominations divide men. Denominations divide fellowship. It's interesting. The denominational spirit is not just the name on the door. But it's a divisive spirit of Satan to divide the people of God, to divide the body of Christ, and make someone higher, lifted up. Well, I'm better over here because I'm Baptist. I'm better over here because I'm Methodist. And it splits everything up. We've seen that type of pride sometimes in our own ranks.
That's right, brother. Amen.
You see, that denominational spirit trying to get in and divide.
Amen.
And that was the result of all these healing campaigns, is to see more denominations going every day, colonize everything. It's still the same men. What we need is to wait till we hear the voice of God as individuals, every man and every woman. Then he says in 1959, again, another place, I remember staying in prayer. He's talking about him getting tired. Staying in prayer for 7 days and nights and eating my meal at the pulpit, determined I would pray for everyone that came before I sat down. There were 10 times more at the last night than there was I started. Then I almost died. I couldn't sleep. Didn't know where I was at hardly. I was so tired and weary. Doesn't pay to do that. Jesus doesn't want us to do that. He wants us to take care of ourselves. Well, that's an interesting quote. No wonder, no one never know what those visions does to me. They're awful hard on me. And if it could just be one, and then the rest of them would be all right. So he's saying, if we could just have one vision explained or one discernment of the heart, that should have been enough. But he's having to keep doing it. He gives the reason why he's having to keep doing a bunch of them. He says, if we could just have one, the rest would be all right. But you see, it's one, it's got to be all prayed for that way. In other words, that's what he meant. It's got to be all. And they just don't want to believe it. So the church is not in its right state yet.
Amen.
We have to remember that. It's not matured.
Amen.
Right.
Church is not matured. And he's given the reason he can see they're not matured is that they're leaning on that sign where it's one vision isn't good enough. Listen, to mature people, one vision should be good enough.
Yes.
God's here. You don't need to ever do it again. Matter of fact, you know the kind of maturity we need in our lives? We need to say before God, we need to say in our hearts, if God never did another miracle ever on this earth, I'm not going anywhere. I'm going to serve him with all my heart. If God never answered another prayer, I'm going to serve him anyway. Now, do we need the supernatural God showing himself among us? Yes, we do. For who? Not for me to stay in the message, but for our children to see that God is real, for them to receive the Holy Ghost. So don't ever stop praying for God to move that way. It's just that I live every day that, God, if you never show me another supernatural sign, never another thing, never do another miracle, I'm not going anywhere. I'm not leaving the message. Can you say amen? I'm not leaving this Christ that I serve every day. I'll go on to the rapture if I never see another thing. Why? Because that's maturity. I've already seen enough to convince me. That's the way we should be. People get so immature, like little babies. Unless I see this, if Jesus comes down from the cross, then I'll believe. Same spirit. Lack of maturity in the people. So he says it's not mature, so we just have to linger and do the best we can. He's talking about in those meetings, because the people aren't mature. He lingers and does the other visions, and there's no one can bring it to maturity. I love this quote. There's no one can bring the church to maturity, only the Holy Spirit as we listen to it. I don't believe it'll ever come by man. It'll have to come by God.
Amen.
So you see the expectations? You see what we yield to the Lord? Lord, mature me. Lord, this is so important. Mature me as a son, as a daughter of God.
Amen. Amen.
So I'm determined to stay expecting and believing to see in my life and others' life the final fruits of what this message was sent to do. I'm not satisfied with just a wave sheaf. How many know what the wave sheaf is? That in the Old Testament, he took the first of the crop that had come to maturity, and he waves that in front of the whole congregation to show what? The first one's come to maturity, but it's not just that one. The whole crop has to come to maturity.
Amen.
I'm not interested in just seeing the wave sheaf, the first to come to maturity. We're under expectation for the entire crop to come to maturity.
Amen.
There are influences in the message sometimes to keep us rejoicing over the wave sheaf. Can I say it again? There are influences sometime among us to keep us rejoicing over the wave sheaf, over the first one to come to maturity. And we keep talking about that and keep talking about it. But listen, my expectation is not just that the first sheaf came to maturity. There's a whole crop, and I'm a part of that crop. Lord, bake all the greenness out of my life. Lord, take all the immaturity out of my life. Let me grow in grace and become the mature son of God that I should be. Amen. Let me see the rest of the crop mature in divine love, in humility, in grace, and in dominion. Somebody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Praise the Lord. So now in our reading in the text, Paul said, he tells what this Spirit is, this Holy Ghost that comes to us, what it really is when we receive it. It's the Spirit of adoption. And that tells us that the Spirit of adoption is to bring a son to his position and grow to his position as an adopted son. And that's part of growing to maturity, coming to maturity as a son.
Amen.
So now, though you're birthed by the Spirit, and there's different ministers that speak it different ways, but this is just the way I see it. You receive the Spirit of adoption, but you're not fully adopted yet, only potentially. In other words, you have the Spirit and all the potential. You're going to be adopted.
Yeah.
Can you say amen? None of this stuff that says if you receive the Holy Ghost and it's the Spirit of adoption, you're going to be adopted.
Because
you've got the Spirit of adoption.
Yeah. That's right.
None of this say, oh, he's out. No. But as Brother Branham expressed, the behavior until that son comes into the right obedience and he grows, you see. But if it's the Spirit of adoption, because I used to preach when I was a young preacher, I used to say that adoption was based upon behavior. In other words, it's all based upon your behavior, whether you're adopted or not. No, it's not ultimately upon your behavior, because if you have the Holy Ghost, it's the Spirit of adoption. You will be adopted.
That's right.
If you're a son and daughter of God, you always were a son and daughter of God.
That's right.
Can you say amen? If my sons,
amen.
If my sons make a mistake, they're still my sons.
Yeah.
They're going to come to maturity. I've got one named, I got Gideon and I got Solomon. I got Solomon. Sometimes these boys, Solomon, he don't have a lot of wisdom sometimes like Solomon in the Bible, but there's a lot of grace because he's growing in maturity.
Amen.
You see? And they're my sons. I don't say, okay, you're out, bud. You're finished. You're not my son anymore. God does it. If that's true about me as a dad, it's true about God.
Amen.
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 You're a son of God. You're going to come hard or you're going to come easy. But you're going to come.
Amen.
Some of you come real hard, didn't you? Took a lot to get you here. Took you a lot to get you here. So it doesn't matter whether you come easy or whether you come hard. All sons of God, all the Father has given me will come. So I just want to make sure I lay the foundation of the adoption the way that it's presented here. You receive the Spirit of adoption, which means that which is birthed in you is in baby form, but it has the potentials to become mature sons and daughters of God.
Amen.
Completely led by God in all things. Those that have the Spirit of God are led by the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Those that are the sons of God are led by the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Isn't that our journey as a Christian, to learn how to be led?
Amen.
That every day when we get up, Lord, don't let my human mind lead me, but let me be one of those sons that's truly led by the Spirit. What I say, what I do, what I post on the internet. You see, a lot of times it's carnality. It's your flesh.
Amen.
But we got to get out of that immature mold. We got to get out of this mold that we're just real godly here in church. We can't do that anymore. We got to mature as sons.
Amen.
If I'm a son of God here, I'm a son of God out there. I'm a son of God when I'm posting on the internet. I'm a son of God when I go to work.
Yes. Right.
What I represent here is what I represent out there. That's maturity. Amen. Immaturity is living two different lives. You see, we can't do that. We must become mature sons and completely led by God in all things every day. In verse 19, then it goes into the prophecy, if you still have your Bible open, of the day of manifestation of sons. He says, for the earnest expectation, creature waited for the manifestation of the sons of God. And because the prophet broke this down as not just being the rapture, but it's a time when sons come to the full expression of maturity.
Amen.
That they can be trusted.
Yeah.
Maybe you're looking at yourself tonight saying, boy, Brother Paul, I don't know if I'm ever going to get there. And maybe some other people in the church are wondering about you if you ever get there. And you're wondering about others. Well, you should just lay all that down. And you should pray that everyone receives the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Because if they receive the spirit of adoption, no matter what you think of them or what they think of you, we got to pray us on to maturity.
Amen.
That we're manifesting mature sons and daughters of God in our everyday life. That's what we're looking for under expectations. So now, the prophecy is the manifestation of sons. In other words, the sons of God, they will come into everything that Adam lost in the last days.
That's right.
We will come into everything that Adam lost. Number one, dominion.
Yeah.
Dominion over all things.
Yeah.
People think that comes someday in the millennium. I'm one that believes that we already have the power of God to take dominion over things now.
Amen.
Now this earth, it belongs to all them, but even this earth will become ours again someday.
Right.
We can't go in and say, you know, this prophet, go into the city and say, okay, this is mine because I'm a son of God. We can't do that yet. But someday, they're going to have to give it all up to sons of God.
Amen.
This is all owned by us.
Amen.
Can you say amen? I might be up here more often in Newfoundland after we take it over.
Amen.
Yeah, I like it. It'd be great, you see. So let them go ahead and do whatever they want. But one day, this is all coming back to sons and daughters of God. We'll have ownership. But the dominion is not just someday. You can have dominion over your whole life right now.
Amen.
Not too many amens on that.
Amen.
We got. Now are we the sons of God?
Yes. Amen.
So let's start with dominion over ourselves.
That's right.
Instead of you trying to control somebody else, what about dominion over your own attitude? What about dominion over your own spirit?
Amen.
What about dominion over your own thoughts?
Amen.
These are the things we exercise our dominion over.
That's right.
It's our domain. This is our domain that's been given to us.
Yeah, that's right.
The things that we own, our houses. I may not be able to control the atmosphere in a restaurant, but I can control the atmosphere in my home.
Amen.
I can make my environment. Because I'm a son of God, I make it the way I want it.
Amen.
So we're exercising dominion. That's the first thing. But I think there's more to this than just exercising dominion. We're coming back to everything that Adam lost because of Calvary. And we come to a mature sonship, as Brother Branham explained in adoption, when that son comes to the maturity, you see. So it's growing to a place that he's believing and doing like his father. Can you say amen?
Amen.
So in exercising mature sonship, just as Jesus did, because remember, Jesus came to his adoption. He's exercising everything that Adam lost.
Amen.
Jesus came to his adoption. Jesus came to sonship.
Right.
All sons of God must come to sonship,
right.
Must come to adoption.
Right.
We often think this is not possible in this life because we live in the flesh. But I believe this is my expectation. Lord, let me see in my life, and in my church, and in the people of God, Lord, let me see, this is my expectation, let me see more maturity.
Amen.
Because I see many times in my own life and others, of those confessing the message, a lot of immaturity still.
Amen.
I won't preach to you, I'll preach to myself.
Amen.
Sometimes something comes out of me and say, God, that's such immaturity.
Amen.
Help me grow out of that.
Amen.
Help me not to look at things that way. And this weekend we'll get into how the prophet matured and how he come to things towards the end of his ministry. Even after the seals are open, we see God dealing with him on certain things and certain attitudes in his own life. Praise the Lord. We have to be willing. So the full adoption of sons now at the end time has two parts to it. And brother, and Paul brings it in Romans here. The full adoption of sons has two parts to it. Right in the scripture, number one, the mature sons walking in the manifestation of maturity, dominion, and humility. I'm going to say it that way. The manifestation of the sons of God. Mature, number one, walking into manifestation of maturity, dominion, and humility. And then, for the adoption to wit, then it's rapture.
Amen.
Because that's the ultimate adoption. It's not going to end in a body like this. It's going to end in a new body.
Amen.
Paul says that we're waiting for adoption to wit, the final completion. But often we jump to that and say that's all the final adoption is just rapture. I personally believe it's not that way because he says all creation is waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. There's an expectation for something greater in them before they go into rapture. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
So both of these things, both the maturity and both the body change, will come because God sent a message in the last days that he sent to bring us back to Bible faith. If you don't understand, I want to express it to you tonight if you don't know. If you hear me refer to the prophet and refer to the last days message a lot, it's because it's so important to us, and we refer to it because this message of the last days was sent, according to Malachi 4, according to Luke 17:30. God said he sent a message to get us back to Bible faith.
That's right.
To bring us back to Bible faith. No denomination can completely bring us back to full faith in the Bible. Because they always got a tainted thing to it. They got their own interpretation. And God says, I'm going to work outside of any denomination. I'm going to send Elijah, can you say amen? And he's going to restore us back to the faith that was once delivered to the Father. Back to the faith in our Bibles. Open the Bible to us, can you say amen? Why was he? You say, well, my Bible's not closed to me. I've got my Bible here tonight. How did it become closed, our Bibles? Because church systems put a veil over our eyes that we couldn't see it right.
That's right.
And God says in the end, at the last days, I'll send a man. He'll rip all the veils away so you can see the Bible right.
Amen.
So you can look in Genesis and see that wasn't an apple that he ate. That Eve ate. It wasn't an apple. There was sin in the garden. And sons of God begin to see this. And they see the Bible the way they're supposed to see it.
Amen.
So if you hear me refer to Brother Branham, believing that he fulfills that, if you'd have been sitting in a service 2,000 years ago in the time of Paul, you would have heard Paul's name quite a bit.
Amen.
He wrote 14 books of the New Testament. And the apostles and the pastors and the bishops and the preachers were preaching, but they would have referred to Paul quite a bit because why? He had a significant place in the church as the apostle and the prophet to bring it to the Gentiles. And he didn't give that to himself. God gave him that position. So you got 14 letters being sent to the churches. They're standing up there reading those letters. So you're going to hear Paul said this and Paul said that and Paul, well, man, we're hearing Paul's name a lot. What about Jesus Christ? That is lifting up Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Because Paul, that message of that day was bringing us to the revealing of Christ.
Amen.
Let me just stop here just a minute. I love this part. Paul was the first one who used the term the mystery of Christ. John referred to the revelation of Christ. Now, you don't hear that term until Paul starts to preach. Because, you see, it wasn't just about Christ of Nazareth in the four Gospels. That's what he did on earth. But his ministry didn't stop there. So when Paul says, I preach Christ in a mystery, he's preaching something deeper than just Jesus of Nazareth who walked the shores of Galilee. He's the first one to use the term, the mystery. What's the mystery of Christ? Why? It ought to make you perk up and say, wow, he's going to preach something here further of the revealing of Christ.
Right.
Remember, Paul's the only one that didn't meet him in the flesh. He met him at a pillar of fire.
Amen.
But who was it in the pillar of fire? It was Jesus.
Right.
So all the disciples, you think they had more on Paul than all the rest. And that's why you have churches sometimes. I'm only going to listen to the red letter edition. I'm only going to listen to the apostles that wrote about Jesus that was with him. Paul, I don't know. There's a whole book out that says, how do we have give authority to Paul? He wasn't even with Jesus. We're going to listen to more of the people who was with Jesus. That's crazy.
Amen.
Because Paul says, I'm going to preach the mystery of Christ to the Gentiles.
Amen.
You ought to be perking up saying, okay, I want to hear it. There's more to just, he walked the shores of Galilee. He multiplied the fishes and loaves. Praise the Lord, that was enough. But there's more to it. There's a mystery in him. Well, praise the Lord, there was a mystery in Adam.
Amen.
If there was a mystery in Adam, which was Eve, there's a mystery in Christ.
That's right.
And one day God took that mystery out of Adam, and he took his rib, and he made Eve, which is a revelation of what come out of Adam. Right. One day at Calvary, they poked his side with a spear, and out come water, out come blood. The spirit of life come out of there. Can you say amen?
Amen.
But his days, when it's not over, if there's a first Adam and a second Adam, there's a first Eve, but there's a second Eve.
Amen.
There's a second Eve.
Hallelujah.
And she's the mystery in Christ.
Amen.
Blessed be his
Hallelujah.
Name. That's why you hear, that's why what Paul said is important. Because he's not just going to tell about Jesus in Nazareth, and that's all wonderful. But now he's going to preach the mystery. There's something laying in Christ here that's going to unfold in the church.
Amen.
Bride of Jesus Christ. And that'll climax at the end time with a marriage. Can you say amen?
Amen.
It's at the end that there's a marriage. The marriage of the Lamb has come, book of Revelation. And his bride has made herself ready. He's not just dating the church anymore. It's a marriage. I heard a preacher say it last week. He said, you know, this isn't a dating relationship. Now that the message has come, this isn't dating Christ. This is marrying Christ. It's an invisible union.
Yeah.
If you're dating somebody, you just make appointments and dates. I'll see you on Sunday, you know, I'll meet you there at church on Sunday. Lord Jesus, I'll meet you at church Sunday. You're making a date. That's a date. That's a courtship. It's not a marriage. And then you decide when you're there Sunday, you say, okay, well, I'll come next Sunday. I'll meet you here. That's just appointments. It's just making a date. Maybe I'll be here Wednesday. I don't know. Most of my people don't come Wednesdays. Can I say that on here? It's going to get back home. And some people, they're not able to make it, but some people are not in a marriage. They're in a dating with Jesus. Just making appointments. They're just Sunday morning Christians. But this message, this last day's prophecy is not a dating. This is a marriage. And in a marriage, you're with the person every day. Somebody say praise the Lord. You're with him every day. This is an intimate relationship. This isn't just Sunday mornings. This is every day an intimate relationship with him.
Amen.
That's the kind of relationship we're in with Christ right now. And he spoke of a mystery. And this preacher's got to get going because I got a lot of hay on my fork tonight. I got to quit getting sidetracked here but I trust it's a blessing to you.
Amen.
Look at that. Look at that. Paul's the first one to mention the mystery of Christ. Look at that now. He goes into this whole thing of the Christ and the bride coming out and just, oh, it's just miraculous. So you're going to hear his name back in that day a lot. You're going to hear referred to Paul, and Apostle Paul said this, and Apostle Paul said that, and, you know, quotes, quotes, quotes. But all of it was to preach the mystery of Christ.
That's right.
And Paul would have told you, and Brother Branham would have told you, this isn't about me.
Right.
This is about preaching Christ.
Amen.
Both those prophets would tell you the same thing.
Amen.
So the body change is because God sends a word. Let me make it just understandable here. When Isaiah said and prophesied, a virgin shall conceive, 400 years later, an angel re-spoke it to Mary.
Wow.
All right?
Amen.
So a prophet says it, because all these things come out of prophet speaking things.
That's right.
400 years later, an angel sent to Mary to re-speak that to her personally. And she believed it. And it set her under expectation. Oh, praise be to God.
Amen.
That's what I'm preaching about tonight.
Amen.
Being set under the right expectation.
Amen.
And I'd say she believed it. Something is conceiving in me. I'm not with Joseph, but the Holy Ghost shall overshadow thee. Something will start in you. She didn't have a feeling. She didn't have a sensation. She just believed the word, but she was under expectation. This is going to happen in me. Not in the church, not in the synagogue.
That's right.
And the expectation wasn't just that she's seen an angel. The expectation is that I'm going to bring forth Christ.
Amen.
Oh, somebody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Meeting an angel is a great thing, but it's not as great as Christ being formed in you. So in the same way as the prophecies speak of a bride coming to adoption, he sends an angel of the Lord, the seventh angel in the last days. That's why young people say sometimes, well, if I could just see an angel, we did. We seen the seventh angel.
That's right.
So if I could just have an angel come to me like Mary, well, you did. The seventh angel came to this generation.
That's right.
You seen an angel. Praise the Lord. So we've had it all, but that's not deep enough, just seeing an angel. And so now for 9 months, Sister Kimberly's out, I guess, but 9 months under expectation. Then under expectation, then it finally happened. It happened in real life. Can you say amen? So it's the same today. God prophesies these things, sends his prophet messenger to re-speak it again. But I'm trying to get you to see tonight, the expectation isn't just that God sent a prophet or an angel to speak to us. The expectation is greater than that.
Amen.
It's sons coming to maturity.
Amen.
It's sons coming to maturity. That's our expectation.
Yes.
This prophecy of Paul that there will be a day of the manifestation of the sons of God on earth is starting to happen now. It's the cry of all creation. It's the groaning that's within us. But also, this is the groaning of the entire earth. It's the revival and the move of God that everyone is crying for. Whenever something of God is going on, it's amazing how many catch that something is fixing to happen. Now, there are some who feel the pull of the hour that something's fixing to happen,
amen,
but they don't have the revelation to interpret what's going to happen.
Amen.
But they feel the pull of the hour. I'm using a term there from the prophet. They feel the pull of the hour. That's why we have people that are inspired by God around the world. The same God that I serve can inspire somebody to write an anointed song. And they don't have all the revelation. They don't understand. But God can inspire them. I believe it. We sing some of the songs that are inspired by people who don't necessarily believe the way we believe. God can inspire them. Right? And a lot of times you'll hear, my daughter gave me a CD. Or actually, we sang, our family sang at a festival there in Indiana, the hometown of Bill Gaither. And so every year we were going in and we sing in the tent. And so, we sang there and it just did our gift and sang to the people. And so there was another little group there of young people that they had. And it was a new group, and they had real sincere young people. So they sang a few of their songs. Bill Gaither let them sing a few of the songs just to introduce their music. And so then last year when we were there, Bill Gaither was there, listened to four of our songs, and he said, "We appreciate your songs and different things." So that was nice. But you see now, I met this young girl that was with this group, and she gave me her CD, and I took it home. And you know what all the songs are? This is a new generation coming up in the denominationals. This new generation. You know what all the songs were mostly about? Revival. God send a revival. Their hearts are burning.
Amen.
They're tired of religion. They're tired of denominational systems. There's a cry in their heart.
Amen.
They're feeling the pull of the hour and writing songs about it. I thought, oh, God, if I can be a testimony, a witness to them. But you see now, that can happen not just to the bride. They can feel the pull of the hour. But the problem is when they come into those feelings and the cry, there's a deep calling in them that shows there's something in them. But the problem is the church world takes those pure cries for God, and by lack of revelation, they abuse those expectations and try to say, well, here it is, or here it is, or do this, or here's the revival you're looking for, or, you know, we need to bring rock and roll in the church, and that'll bring the young people. What a lie that is. So they do it in their own human strength, and they wear themselves out searching for the right thing. They give them another program, or they give them another worldly attraction, they get into a charity, something else to get the people doing something. And it's to fill that need and cry for the expectation of what they're looking for. And then we might as well bring this closer, because Jesus said the Spirit would be so close in the last days, it would deceive the very elect if it were possible. Within our own ranks, people rise and say, it's over here, it's over there. Lord, help me just to say this right. Within our own ranks, sometimes people through the last 50, 60 years, it's over here. You got to hear this great teacher in the message. It's over here. It's in Jeffersonville. It's in New York. It's in South Africa. You better stay tuned to this brother's website. He's bringing rapturing faith. It's over here. I'm going to read the scripture, but Jesus talked about that. Low here, low there. You see? But all this fanaticism sometimes comes because the sincere heart's looking for the cry, what's next?
That's right.
Amen. Right? There's a guy in Alabama, some 20 years ago, and he played his guitar in a special way and had a special pick. And you wouldn't believe the people would follow it, because they were saying he was going to bring the bride into rapturing faith when he played the guitar. If you listen to the guitar, it has this like heavenly sound to it. And when he sang, it's just this guitar, just really nice, you know? Come to find out later, it's just a certain setting on his machine that gave it that real radiant sound, and it sounded real good. It wasn't anything rapturing faith. It was just his machine on his guitar. But you wouldn't believe how many people followed that. What? A cry for rapturing faith. A cry for expectation. But Satan can misguide you.
Amen.
You see? So much of this stuff went on. I'm tired of it.
Amen.
My cry, say, Lord, put me under the right expectations for my life. Help me preach the right expectations to the people. See, that's immaturity to follow something like that. And that's what they need is maturity in the Word to know what's coming. Jesus pointed to it as in Matthew 24, talking about the last days, that if any man shall say unto you, lo, here is Christ, or there, believe it not, for there shall rise false Christ, false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Behold, I have told you before. Wherefore, if they shall say unto you, behold, he's in the desert, go not forth. Behold, he's in the secret chambers, believe it not.
Amen.
For as the lightning come out of the east and shine in the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For wheresoever the carcass is, there will be the eagles gathered together.
Amen.
Don't fall to those things. It has to be this website. It's got to be over here. It's got to be over there. No, I'll tell you where. It's when this bride is feeding on this word, healed by the Holy Ghost, do what he needs to do. Lo, here, it's probably right here in Newfoundland tonight.
Amen.
Just feeding on the word.
Amen.
That's where the eagles are gathered. You still with me?
Amen.
Nobody told me how long to preach, so you're all in trouble. Nobody gave me an instruction. I got instructions on everything else, but nobody told me how long, except the sound man who says my microphone lasts 8 hours. I said, you should never tell a preacher that. Don't ever tell a preacher that. Are you with me tonight? A lot of this stuff is brand new. And, you know, and sometimes when a preacher is just presenting things, but this is what's on my heart.
Amen.
It's what the Lord told me to say.
Amen.
And sometimes you go back to an old message or something and preach it again, but these are fresh things tonight for me because this is what's on my heart.
Hallelujah.
Being under expectation to see mature sons.
Amen.
That's what we're under expectation
Amen.
For. I know we expect the rapture. But before the rapture, Lord, mature me into a son of God.
Amen.
Burn all the immaturities out of me.
Amen.
So we have more of this sometimes in our ranks. He's over here, he's over there, right in our ranks. We ought to quit all this and just feed on the word of God. Amen. Let the Holy Spirit do it. There were other expectations laying in the Bible. Many of you believers know that there was expectations and cries for the last days. And we watch them fulfilled in Malachi 4, Matthew 17, 11, Acts 3, 21, Revelations 5, 7, Revelations 10, 1, Revelations 10, 7. All these were scriptures waiting to be fulfilled, and we have seen them fulfilled. People were crying for them. You see, now all that being fulfilled puts us in the cycle for Romans 8, 19 to be fulfilled, that we're waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. Actually, all those scriptures of Malachi and Matthew, all those contribute to bringing us to Romans 8, 19, the manifestation of the sons of God.
Amen.
It's a further fulfillment than all of these. The fulfilling of these scriptures bring forth the expectation and the fulfillment of manifested sons. This is where we are now. It does not say that all creation groans for a prophet to come. Did anybody notice that? That all creation, it doesn't say that all creation groans for God to send a prophet. It doesn't say that. Even though we were groaning for it, we needed it. A prophet is what we needed. It was in the scripture. But that's not what all creation's groaning for. It's groaning for something deeper to come from that. It doesn't say that all creation is groaning or for the mysteries to be revealed. All creation wasn't groaning for the mysteries to be revealed. It's groaning under expectation of the manifestation of the sons of God. The message is to bring this adoption to pass. It's an adoption age. How many believe that? But having the message does not mean you have come to full adoption yet.
Amen.
If you have the Holy Ghost, you have the potential for it. But having the message does not mean you have come to full adoption yet. Amen. Notice he says here about the serpent. In 1958, he's smart, he's crafty, and yet he's called the serpent. But remember, he was the smartest thing there was, and the more like the human being than anything else that was on the field. Closest to the human being. He was not a reptile. The curse made him a reptile, and he was, the Bible said he was the most beautiful of all. Yeah. And when even the curse didn't take all of his beauty away, yet the glorious colors of the snake is beautiful, and his grace and his shrewdness, even the curse didn't move it off. But you remember, God told him that his legs would come off and he'd go on his belly, and you can't find one bone in a snake that looks like a human being, and that's the reason science is lost. But there he is. God hid it from the wise and prudent. The only thing I've ever read is a scientific magazine had an article that said one time that some of the DNA in a snake showed that he originally was a creature that stood on his feet. The DNA has it in there. But you can't find one bone of it in his body now because God was hiding something. God so hid it that this world would miss it. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And look how he says it now. You can't find one bone in a snake that looks like a human being, and that's the reason science is lost. But there he is. God hid it from the eyes of the wise and prudent and promised to reveal it to the sons of God in the last days when the sons of God would be made manifest, when God's Son that rejoiced with him before the foundation of the world, when the great revelation of the Godhead and things that we'd be brought to the last days, he would manifest these things to sons of God. You know the scripture teaches that, and here we are. That's the reason that God is opening these things to us. God is bringing his sons into manifestation. He's going beyond the limitations of human knowledge, way into the spiritual revelations and bringing down. Did you hear what he said?
Amen.
These mysteries being revealed were sent back to sons in the last days so they catch something. And they come to their manifestation that they are sons. I'll read one more before I preach on it a little bit. He says in adoption, Father, Son, Holy Ghost is false, bogus Catholic dogma and not a Christian baptism. That's right. Luther brought it from the Catholic Church with catechism. Wesley adopted and come on. But this is the day of the manifestation of the sons of God when the mysteries that's been hid since the foundation of the world is to be made known. This is the hour. So listen now, sons being given these mysteries, the mysteries are important. The revealing of them is important. But sons being given these things, when they catch it by revelation, it brings on this manifestation of the sons of God.
Amen.
When you really see what happened in the garden, then you understand by discernment and by revelation, you start to understand what God's taking you back to.
Amen.
Now just catch this a minute. If you didn't have that revelation, you'd never be able to see the full redemption of what a son comes to.
That's right.
So that had to be revealed to sons. And we don't stop there, but as that revelation grows, when you really see what happened in the garden, then you see why you acted in rebellion to the word.
Yeah.
Don't you?
Amen.
Why did I react such in rebellion to the word? But you see what happened in the garden, you understand the nature you were born with. But then you see when God reverses that by a pure seed in Mary and what it looked like in Jesus, then you start seeing how powerful it is now in your life. Causes sons to rise to their place and put you under expectation for the time now. Think of it. The power over you of the first Adam falling. One falling affected such power over us that we fell so low.
Amen.
We didn't even do it to ourselves. Do you realize that? You realize the prophet said you can't even repent of that nature you were born with. You can't even repent of that. You didn't give it to yourself. You repent of your sins, but you can't repent of it. God had to deal with that nature himself through Calvary.
That's right.
You can't repent of something that you didn't even put on yourself. You were born with it.
Amen.
But look how powerful Adam and Eve falling, look at the power. It's, and I don't even have words to describe it, such a power over your life that no matter how good you would try to do, there's a serpent nature on your soul.
Yes.
That wants to worship God its own way, but wants to live in rebellion to the Word.
Right.
I mean, that's pretty powerful. And you know how it happened? It's because Adam and Eve got out of place. Adam and Eve fell. A serpent came in, born with a serpent nature. Talk about being cursed. We were born cursed.
Amen.
But listen now, but if it was that powerful in that way, then look how powerful it will be when God reverses it. And by one man, the second Adam, can so powerfully reverse the effects of a nature. It can go right to your soul and change your nature, that the serpent nature is no longer there. You couldn't do anything about that. Look how powerful it is. Look how wonderful that is. Reverses the whole thing, washes you away from all of your sins. Can you say amen? And where does it place you? As a son of God, in God's eyes, back to where Adam was. He looks at you the way he looked at Adam before the fall.
Amen.
Sons of God, arise. You should know where you stand. Can you say amen? These revelations of the serpent seed and Godhead bring us back to an understanding of who we are as sons. Such a power, can you say amen, to lift us back up to what Adam lost. So today we witness the most extreme. I'm going to skip some of this now because I realize I'm getting just a bit long. I was going to talk about the many evidences in society that we have of fallen men. And I just might make a comment that it is the image, not only fallen man, but the immaturity in people today. In an age when God's calling us to maturity, if you live feeding on those things, it keeps you in an immature state. Paul said in 1 Corinthians, when I became a man, I put away childish things.
That's right.
Right?
Amen.
So when we preach these things, we're living in an age of childlikeness. Most people are big kids in adults' clothes. It's everywhere.
Right.
Teaches us to react like children in everything, to be self-centered, to fight for your own way. These are all immaturities. To rebel against authority. All immaturities. It's in society. It's in that serpent nature. It can spill over into us. But we're not called to stay immature.
Amen.
And I've watched it as a pastor. There's a problem with this society. One of the greatest things is the failure of men to take their position as men.
Right.
In the church.
Amen.
They're wishy-washy sometimes. And they answer to no one. They never ask for wisdom from the older ones. They're taught to disrespect parents and everyone that's older. The average emotional age of people under pressure, I read this the other day. The average emotional age of people under pressure, how they act under pressure, the average emotional age is 13 years old. That's how they act. And you know how a 13-year-old acts. Under pressure now, this is how they'll react. They'll cuss and swear and throw things like a 13-year-old. So I don't want to go on with that, but I'm just saying this is the age of immaturity, and God's not calling us to that. He's calling us to be mature sons. It's in the Word that we find this great expectation. I'm bringing this down to a close here pretty soon. In the Word, we find this great expectation of creation, the groaning inside, what they've been looking forward to all the time. All animal life, all botany life has been under expectation. What is it? The manifestation of the sons and daughters of God. For you to find your place as a son and mature into a son. To come to perfection and maturity, all creation's waiting for it. You ever wonder what's in the spirits? Because they don't have a soul, but it's what's in the spirits really deep in these animals? You ever wonder what's really deeply in their spirit? The Bible tells us. They're groaning for the manifestation of the sons of God.
That's
You ever wonder really what they're thinking? And, you know, for my dog, I have a little dog. I don't like dogs, but my family likes it. And what's on my dog's mind is food all the time. That's what the dogs, that's what I've learned about dogs. They always want the food. But the Bible tells us that there's something in the spirit of all this creation, something deeper that's waiting for us, that's under expectation. They're not, you know, what is the animal life? And by the way, they're not thinking of the next movie coming out like some people. They're not thinking of what's the newest style of clothes. They're not thinking who's going to be the next president or prime minister. They're not thinking of what's the next top song on the charts. That's us human beings. They're not thinking about how many killings took place, when my next promotion is, or when my next vacation is. That's us human beings.
Amen.
No, the main expectation of that creation is true sons coming to adoption,
Amen.
Taking back over the earth.
Amen.
So I say to you tonight, if that's their expectation, shouldn't it be our expectation too? Shouldn't it be our expectation? Should we just put lesser things aside and say, Lord, I'm looking to you under expectation to mature my life and bring me into the manifestation position that I should be in?
Amen.
Walking in it every day, can you say amen?
Amen?
Should that not be what's mostly on our hearts all the time?
Amen.
Growing into full believers and helping others do so as well.
Amen.
I wonder if creation looks at us sometimes and gets frustrated with us. Remember, they're waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. They get frustrated with us, and we're living so consumed by earthly things sometimes. Wonder if the creation could talk and say, hey, all you message believers, God sent a message in the last days by a vindicated prophet to reveal all you need to know to find your full position in Christ. What are you doing? I know animals don't talk, but maybe if they could, they'd be saying this. They're groaning for the manifestation of the sons of God to find their position. What are you acting like? You're acting like the rest of your school, your workmates. What are you doing that for? You're not them. You're called to something else. Get with the program. We're waiting on you. We've had 6,000 years of this. This is enough of a fallen world. This is enough of a world of death. Sons of God, find your place. We want deliverance, and we'll get it when you come to your liberty. We'll come to our liberty. I wonder if the animals could talk. That's what they'd say to sons of God. Quit living like the rest of them and getting caught up in the rest of that. It's time for you to find your place.
Amen.
We're waiting on that.
Amen.
Our liberty doesn't come until you get your liberty.
Amen.
And your deliverance in the body. Oh, to have a church with the same expectations. Sometimes I don't know what people are coming to church for sometimes. There has to be an expectation in our hearts, friends.
That's right.
There has to be a constant expectation in our hearts. It's not necessarily for another revival or another special meeting, but it's an everyday living in discernment with Him, walking in dominion with Him, and maturing, saying, God, burn out my immaturities. Can you say amen? It's saying every day, God, what can you show me that I may press to this high calling in Christ? Lord, what is next in my life? What is grieving you? And the prophet said, find what is grieving you. He says, stop grieving Him and do the things that please Him.
Amen.
Because even somebody with the Holy Spirit can grieve His Spirit.
Yeah.
Grieve not the Holy Spirit until you're sailed into the day of your redemption.
Amen.
So the prophet says, stop doing things that grieve Him and do the things that please Him.
Amen.
We're not talking about at church. It's easy to do that here.
Yeah.
We're talking about sons living in their position every day.
Amen.
Say, Lord, how can I please you today? How can I be led by you today?
Amen.
God, help me not to give in to gossip.
Amen.
Gossip is immaturity.
Amen.
Something comes up in the church, God, don't let me lean to the gossip with everybody else and tear somebody down. That's immaturity.
Amen.
God, take these immaturities out of the people of God.
Amen.
It destroys the unity in a church.
Amen.
God, help me not to be a selfish person, only thinking of myself. Help me to live for others.
Amen.
God, these little maturities of me reacting and a trial comes and I just react so bad and I go to the depths of depression. Help me to conduct myself as a daughter and son of God in the midst of my trials and say I'm ready to go through it with my Lord because I know He'll bring me out the other side.
Amen.
I'm talking about maturity tonight.
Amen.
Doesn't matter how small the church is, how big the church is, this is the expectation of the bride of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And I speak this from my heart because I'm looking to this in me and I'm looking into my church. There's too many immaturities still there. God, come and take our immaturities out.
Amen.
Let me see a people grow out of just being message intellectuals and people that are comfortable just to be in a message church. Let me grow out of that and let me have a personal walk with him every day.
Amen.
That God could trust me with his power.
Amen.
That God could shine his light through me to somebody else.
Amen.
Do you understand, friends? I trust that you got the message tonight. And there's so many more quotes and things, I'm going to skip them, but because I believe you got it. You excuse me for being so long. But you see now, we're in a time that God is calling his bride, not just to another special meeting. Not just to be dazzled by another mystery. I've been around this, thankfully, since 19. My dad was blessed to be able to see God sent a prophet in 1965. He was a Baptist and Pentecostal, and then God brought him to Further Light. And then he was 65. He came in. His pastor was coming in, Brother Samuel Johnson. He was coming in Further Light. He was a presbyter over so many denominations, and he was coming out of that, but my dad didn't know, and my dad had ordered a minister's license from him, and he went over to his house to pick up his minister's license, and his pastor had already made the decision to come out, and when he handed the minister's license to my dad, he shook his hand, and he says, well, welcome to Babylon. My dad goes, what? And he sat down with him, shared, and he said, I'm pulling out of the denominational systems and Babylon confusion, coming to the light of the hour.
Amen.
So I only say that to say God dealt with him. God gave him a dream and different things to lead him. And then he brought our family into the light of this. And, you know, just he tried to bring some of his own siblings and family members in it, tried to witness to them. But he came in. He recognized that God had spoke through his prophet and brought us back to scriptural faith. And also he applied the token. So when I was born, you know, after two or three years, he applied the token, got all the trash out of the house and all the influences of the world. A lot of times it's said that that's why our gifts of music was developed so much, is when Dad made the decision to get rid of the TV, get rid of these things, and our gifts for the Lord could develop that way.
Amen.
Now our gift has went around the world, literally around the world.
Amen.
And we never did any of that. It's just a God bless. When Dad applied the token to his home,
Amen.
There was trickle-down effects for it. But I was born in 66 the next year. Nothing significant about that year except I was born. That was pretty much it. The only other thing I know is disposable diapers were invented in 1966, which I was really happy they came out the year I was born. My mom was happy. So it wasn't anything else significant. But you see now, I'm saying that to say I was blessed to be able to grow up in this. You see? But the thing with growing up in it, and then just to give you my testimony, I gave my heart to the Lord 8 years old. I was baptized at 8 years old. And then when I was 16 years old, as the scripture says, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Then at a camp, while I was listening to Brother Harold Hildebrandt preach the word at a camp, youth camp, while he was preaching the word, I believe I received the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah!
Amen.
And, you know, he didn't have to push me to come to the altar. I was already in. God had already done something in my life. And through the word, through the preaching of the word. You see now, in growing up seeing this, you come into a personal relationship with the Lord and you watch the scripture and you watch the word. Then God kind of brings me into a ministry later on and doing different things. But my heart for the Lord is simple. It's still the same. Longing to see what he sent the prophet to do. Longing to see the results in me and in the people of God.
Amen.
And you watch, if you're in it this many years, you're not the different segments and the different doctrines and people pull off and give all these different formulas and this is going to bring us into rapturing faith. And I'm at a state in my life at 53. You know how you get when you get over 50, you don't care what people think what you say anymore. And I'm going to stay and say, I don't want to be a part of any of that. I want to find what the expectation is truly from the scripture.
Amen.
Can you say amen?
Amen?
I want to know what God is going to bring forth in this bride.
Amen.
We had too many years of being distracted by all these different things. And it's time for we let the Holy Spirit finish this work
amen.
In the bride of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So I'm excited tonight.
Amen.
I'm under expectations tonight.
Amen.
Not from man, but what the Holy Ghost will do.
Right.
Doesn't matter if it's Newfoundland, Africa, wherever it's at, Toledo. Listen, it's the same Holy Spirit. He's going to bring a bride to perfection.
Amen.
And I will believe, I will see even before the rapture, I'll see some real signs of maturity in this bride like we've never seen before, that God can trust her. Because you know, Brother Bram talks about the manifestation. He hints in there about going down the street, silver and gold have I none, such as I have, and these different supernatural things taking place in the bride. We don't emphasize that, but he speaks of it. And so, but I believe it's because God can trust us in our maturity.
That's right.
Amen.
That God could trust us to do those things.
Amen.
I want him to trust me.
Amen.
I want to walk every day that I'm available. If he never does a miracle through me, that's fine, but I want to be available.
Amen.
I want him to trust
Amen.
Me. I don't want to be a few days of backslide and then God can't, you know, where's this guy stand? Every day I want him to be able to use me.
Amen.
And God knows this is a son I can use, I can trust.
Amen.
And he's grown in maturity. He's not wishy-washy. He's not up and down. He's not attracted like children are attracted to colors and new things. He's not doing that. He's attracted to the Word of God. And he's all in. Can you say amen? This is the type of maturity we long to see in the bride of Jesus. You love the Lord tonight?
Amen.
Excuse me for taking so long, and I just pray that it'll come together. I always heard that you have a lot of time up here in Newfoundland, and so maybe that's why we took our liberty tonight. You're certainly a lot quieter and slower than America, and that's why Kimberly likes it so much, no doubt. It's just a slower pace here, and it's good. It's a good thing, but I don't mean to abuse that by preaching too long. You love him tonight?
Amen.
Let's stand and pray together. God bless you. Under the expectations of mature sons. We're looking for it, aren't we?
Amen.
We're looking for it in our own lives. We're looking for it in the lives of the bride. Every day, a personal, intimate walk with him, spirit-filled life, led by the Holy Spirit, looking to him for leadership every moment, not our own intellect. And I want to talk a little bit tomorrow maybe about humility and some different characteristics, so not pride of this world and not pride because we're in the message, but the true humility,
Amen.
True maturity, just something that's real solid that the Lord can trust. I want to speak about those things. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for this opportunity tonight. And we just want to bring this service to a close, Lord, and say we love you and we're looking to you, Lord, the author and the finisher of our faith. You're the originator and you're the finisher. You're the one that'll finish the work in this bride. It won't be man that does it. You didn't send a prophet so then man could finish up this message. You're going to finish it yourself, Lord. And this maturity, even that I'm preaching about tonight, you're the one that'll bring it to pass in our lives, Lord. As we grow up that pyramid of faith, virtue, knowledge, temperance, patience, brotherly kindness, Lord, you birthing all those things into us through trials, through temptations, through different things. You're wanting to birth this image of the character of Christ in us, Lord, until we come to that full victory and divine love. Lord, we're looking to these things. This is our expectation, Lord, not for a new doctrine to come along, not for another movement, Lord, in this message, but we're looking to see mature, manifested sons and daughters of God. That's our expectations, Lord. Bless the people tonight. Encourage them. May these things just hang with them, Lord, through the coming days. May it lodge in their hearts, I pray. And we commit the service to you for the glory of God. Amen. Everybody said amen.
Amen.
Amen. I want to live the way he wants me to live. You know that, sis? Let's sing that. I really want to live the way he wants me to live. Song my mom and my sister used to sing with us together. Amen. I want to live the way he wants me to live. I want to give,
yes, Lord,
until there's just no more to give. I want to love till there's just no Lord, help us to lay it down at the altar, Lord. mature as sons and daughters of God. I want to live. I really do, Lord. Oh, God, have mercy in my life, Lord. Hallelujah. There's just no
I try not to preach. Amen. But again, it's easy to do. Oh, yeah. Especially after hearing such a word tonight.
Amen.
Thank God for the word.
Amen.
Amen. I say amen to the fact that there's a lack of maturity in the word.
Yes.
And that's why there's a lack of, going up and growing up, as it were.
Right.
Becoming more mature in the revelation of what God has done. Amen. Because they're caught up with the mechanics,
mm-hmm.
but their shoes that do have the dynamics.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
So I pray the Lord help us, brother, sister. I pray God has spoken to our hearts and put us on our toes to make it sure, brother, we have the correct expectations, the true expectations. And it's true. There are false expectations.
Yes.
And the enemy is certainly here, and I've witnessed that over the last 50 years. Amen. I was dealing with that 50 years ago, and our brother is still dealing with it now.
Yes.
We'll deal with it right on to the time of the rapture,
mm-hmm.
to the time that we're caught away, those
yes.
spirits. Amen.
Yes.
Jesus dealt with it. Amen. Remember, it's the second. There was the first crucifixion of the Word. Now it's the second crucifixion of the Word.
Yes.
So we're experiencing those things.
Amen.
To God be the glory. So I thank God for the Word tonight.
Amen.
Amen. It was the Lord, not our brother Paul, but it was the Lord.
Right.
Amen. He got himself out of the way. I could see that. I said, "Oh Lord," I said, "You're taking over." Amen. And God began to take over and bring His word to our attention.
Right.
Amen. God began to push it down into our hearts, into our souls, by the grace of God. Too many got it in their heads, the
yes.
mechanics. But brother, if you got the dynamics, it's in your soul.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
We're born again on the inside, not the outside.
Yes.
Amen. Is my soul testifies of the new birth. Amen, not my mind. So to God be the glory.
Amen.
Thank God for the word. So let's be in prayer for our brother Paul as the Lord continues to deal with him for service tomorrow.
Amen.
Oh, brother, we were fed tonight. We're going to be fed again tomorrow.
Amen.
Let's delight in the fatness of the word. Oh, I said, that's not good counsel in this modern age. Where people don't want to hear about fat. Well, the Bible says you got to delight yourself in the fatness of the Word of God. Amen. Let's get as good as we can, as big as we can. Amen.
Yes, yes.
Don't see the devil is there. Oh yeah, it's one of the ministry brethren were preaching and he was talking about the devices of the devil. Mm-hmm. The Bible warns us. And I think he must have took out his cell phone. He said, this is one of the Satan's devices. and of course, you get the internet and all these things, the tree of knowledge of good and evil. It's the devices of the devil. Mm-hmm. But thank God for his testimony of his word.
Yeah. Amen.
Praise the revelation of God, the truth of God.
Yeah.
Brother, what we need in this day.
Amen.
Yes.
Brother, the churches are just giving them, as I said, how many out there understand according in the Bible the plan of God, the purpose of God, and the pattern?
Right.
No. They just think, this is something that accidentally happened, and God stepped on the scene to do this, God stepped on the scene to do that. Well, I'll tell you this, God stepped on the scene before it came into existence. He knew all about it, and it's all here, beginning from the beginning to the end.
Amen.
Yes.
The beginning to the end is here. Amen. The plan is here. The pattern is here. The purpose is here.
Amen.
It's not just, this just happened. And so God did this. Oh, thank you, Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, no. He had a purpose. He had a plan.
Right.
And not only that, he had a pattern. Thank God.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we're here tonight, because we see the plan. We see the purpose. And we recognize the pattern.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. If we didn't recognize the pattern, we'd be out there in denomination. But as our brother mentioned, we're dealing with denominational spirits around the message.
Yes, yes.
Oh, yes, most definitely. Because the devil has been on our heels.
Yes. Yes.
Amen. Since we left denominational churches.
Yes, right.
So thank God for our brother Paul.
Amen.
Amen. Thank God for the ministry. Thank God for the anointing,
Amen.
The calling in his life
Amen.
By the grace of God. As I mentioned at the beginning here, that I first met the brother in 88 and at that convention in Alberta, and then it struck me again when he said that Brother Harold Hildebrand was preaching to a youth convention when he gave his heart to the Lord.
Yeah.
Well, I said, Lord, was that when I was there?
Mm-hmm.
I said, in Alberta? Because I said, I was preaching at Brother Harold Hildebrand's assembly, and he was gone to a youth convention to preach.
Amen. Yeah.
Oh, I said, Lord, that might be that might have been the same convention, I said, that
right.
that our brother Paul LaFontaine was, and he gave his heart to the Lord.
Yeah.
It's amazing,
yeah.
absolutely amazing. God knows what he's doing.
Yeah.
Amen. You know, it's amazing. We don't see it, but God sees it.
Amen.
Just follow his leadership.
Amen.
Don't question it. Just do it.
Amen.
Amen. By the grace of God. Amen. So the Lord bless our brother LaFontaine, and thank God for the word through him tonight, and pray the grace of God. And believe that he'll minister to us again tomorrow and Sunday. To God be the glory. Amen, brother. It's the Lord. Amen. Amen. But again, when it comes to maturity, Paul dealt with it. He's right. Amazing. You know, they put so much emphasis on Paul the messenger. That's right. But it was God's plan. It was God's purpose. And just to leave you with this scripture right here, it says, being made perfect, Jesus became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Called of God and high priest after the order of Melchizedek,
yes.
of whom we have many things to say, as our brother would have many things to say regarding what God has done
yes.
and is doing in this hour.
Yes.
Amen. And he said, of whom we have many things to say and hard to be uttered.
Yes.
Seeing, he said, you're dull of hearing.
Oh my. My.
They weren't mature.
Right, exactly.
They weren't mature spiritually.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Amen. And he said, for the time ye ought to be teachers.
Yeah.
Ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God. That's right. Amen. And are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. I trust by the grace of God, we can take the meat of the word. Amen. Brother, you have to be in that position to take what was preached tonight, the meat of the word. Amen. Not milk. Praise God. Why? We're sons and daughters.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Not babies. I trust we're not. We're mature sons and daughters. And it says, for when for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. For every one that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. Strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even to them who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Amen. Praise the Lord. We recognize what God has done and what God is doing. We recognize the plan, the purpose, and the pattern. Praise the name of the Lord. That's good. That's why you're here. If you didn't recognize his pattern, you wouldn't be here. No way. You didn't recognize the plan, you wouldn't be here. Or the purpose of God. Thank God. To God be the glory. Amen. We're going to turn to our brother Bob. Let's sing, We Shall See the King. One, and it says, there's a blessed time that's coming soon. It may be evening, morning, or at noon. The wedding of the bride, amen, I like that. Amen. It's a bride and a bridegroom. It's a husband and wife. Amen, that's good. What our brother brought out. Oh, I pray that it's not just for you on Sunday. It's not for you on Wednesday. Not just for you when you do your devotions in the morning or when you pray this or pray that. No. You're forever united with him. Amen. The marriage of the Lamb has come. And the bride has made herself ready. The bride made herself ready. And now she's in the union with him by the grace of God. Amen. And he's entering into a personal relationship with you. Amen. So there's a blessed time that's coming soon. We'll turn to our brother Bob. God bless you. Amen. There's a blessed time that's coming soon. It may be evening, morning, or at noon. The wedding of the bride, united with the groom. We shall see the king when he comes. We shall see the king. We shall see the king. We shall see.
Yeah.
shall see the King when he comes. Sing it again. Praise the Lord. We shall see the King. We shall see the King. Hallelujah. We shall see the King when he comes. For he's coming. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We shall see the King when he comes. Oh, my brother, are you ready for the call? Praise the Lord. To crown your Savior, King and Lord of all. The kingdoms of this world. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We shall see the King when he comes. We shall see the King. We shall see the King. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. We believe that.
Amen.
But now we believe we shall see the, we shall be with the King when he goes.
Amen.
Amen. Because we know he's here.
Praise
when he goes, we're going to go too, by
Amen.
Grace. Praise the Lord. And that was the icebreaker. I can't wait for tomorrow night.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And
Praise
Sunday. 3:10. 310 is manifesting time.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Let's sing that. The voice of my beloved, behold, he quickly comes, sweeping over the mountains, over the hills he runs. Amen. I long to hear his voice. I long to hear. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. He's coming in. the rock, in the secret place so high, in the daybreak and the shadows flee away. In that mountain place, a sweet smell is coming through. He's that lovely one, he's coming in plain view. It's manifesting time, and the fruits are on the vine, and the lovely one, praise the Lord, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Oh, to cap God's chosen bride, redemption draweth nigh. He's that lovely one, he's coming in plain. The grapes, praise the Lord. The grapes are yours and mine. Little foxes spoil the vine. For the vineyard blossoms for their harvest time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. The fruits. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. In plain view. Oh, to cap God's chosen bride. Redemption draweth nigh. He's that lovely one. He's coming in plain view. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. He is that lovely one to the bride, isn't he? Amen. And I was thinking of a scripture when Brother Paul was preaching there. I was thinking of David. And he said this wonderful thing. He said, it was in Psalm 119, 162 it was. He said, I rejoice at thy word as one who findeth great treasure. And really, that's what we've found tonight. Absolute great treasure. That's how David felt about God. That's how David felt about his word. Amen. It was great treasure to him, and it was more than his necessary meat. And that's where we have to come to. I really believe that.
Amen.
Amen. Let's sing I'm No Longer a Slave to Fear. Brother Paul referred to fear earlier when you began speaking. So let's just sing that this morning, or tonight. And by grace, we can say it with faith in our hearts. That fear doesn't rule us anymore. Amen. Faith diametrically opposed to fear. Amen. Let's just sing it. You have covered me with a melody. Surround me with a song.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears have gone. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. I'm no longer a slave. I am a child Blessed be your name, Lord. Blessed be his name. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, blessed Savior. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. I will bless thee, O Lord. 593. I will bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee, O Lord, with my heart of thanksgiving. Hallelujah. I will bless thee, O Lord. Thank you, Jesus. With my hands lifted up. Thank you, Lord. bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee, O Lord. Hallelujah. I will bless thee, O Lord, with a heart of thanksgiving. Hallelujah. I will bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee, O Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I will bless thee, O Lord. Not enough time in the run of a day to praise him and to thank him for what he's done for us. Praise the Lord. Thy loving kindness is better than life. Amen. I don't have a clock, so, you know, just, I'm not worried about that, really. Amen. You know, we'll just sing, and if anybody wants to leave, then okay. Let's just worship the Lord. This is the dessert part. We had the main course, and we had the appetizers. This is dessert. Give God thanks.
I love kindness. It's better than
Amen. Bless the Lord. Let's sing 850 before we go. Have your way. Praise the Lord. So we'll sing this, and just ask Brother Josh to close in prayer, and just be in prayer for tomorrow night for Brother Paul as he brings God's Amen. Word, and we'll just believe. Amen. Come expecting. Come with that great expectation that been spoken about tonight. Amen. So let's sing and thank God for his grace to us tonight. Let him have his way in each and every one of us.
Have your way. Have your way. Holy Spirit,
Jesus, we are so thankful, Father God, to be gathered, Lord, in your presence, Father, tonight. Amen. Under such a special anointing, Father God. We're so glad, Lord Jesus Christ, that we haven't come to hear from a man, Lord, but Father, you've spoken, Lord Jesus, directly, Lord, Father God, to us.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord Jesus Christ, for your spoken word, Lord. Thank you for your revealed word, Lord Jesus.
Amen.
We're so thankful, Father God, Lord, that we've received, Lord, manna from on high, Father.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, for this evening light, Lord God, that illuminates our way, Father God.
Praise the Lord. I pray grace,
Lord Jesus Christ, that would give us, Lord, the strength, Father God, to mature in your word, Father.
Amen.
Lord, that we would be under a greater expectation, Lord Jesus. Father, give us the grace, Father God, to build that character, Lord, that is fit for a rapture, Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we bless your holy name, and we're so thankful, Lord Jesus Christ, for our brother Paul, Father.
Hallelujah.
Pray, Father God, that you would strengthen him, Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
Speak mightily through him, Father God. Take him out of the way, Lord God.
Amen.
Even as we will meet again, Lord, tomorrow, Lord, throughout this, Lord, weekend, we pray, Father, for your blessed Spirit among us, Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Come and meet with us in a special way, Father.
Yes,
and even as we leave this place, Lord, may your Spirit go with us, Father.
Amen.
We love you, Lord Jesus. We appreciate you, Lord God.
Amen.
I pray that you would meet with all the needs in the body, Father, as we commit our lives, Lord Jesus, into your capable hands.
Yes.
In Jesus Christ's blessed name. Amen.
Thank you, Father.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. God bless you as you go.
Dear.